So now we're going to have a Bible reading. Ali's going to read for us, and that's going to be from John chapter 1, verses 35 to 51.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Ali. I'm one of the city group leaders here at Urban Grace. I'm also involved in the sound team. And quick plug for the sound team, if you're interested in joining our sound team, you don't need any experience. I started with none, and Steve Pelzer trained me. And yeah, so if you like to pretend you're in control, come talk to me, and we can get you trained up for the sound team. My husband and I have been going to Urban Grace for 8 years now, and it's just been a joy to call all of you guys brothers and sisters in Christ. We've grown a lot in our faith here and just made so many meaningful relationships with many of you guys. So we love you, and thanks for letting us be part of the church here. All right, if you guys can turn to John chapter 1, we're in verse 35, and stand just out of respect for God's word. All right, John chapter 1, verse 35. The next day again, John was standing with two of his disciples, and he looked at Jesus as he walked by and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God." The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. Jesus turned and saw them following and said to them, "What are you seeking?" And they said to him, "Rabbi," which means teachers, "teacher, where are you staying?" And he said to them, "Come and you will see." So they came and saw where he was staying, and they stayed with him that day, for it was about the 10th hour. One of the two who heard John speak and followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his own brother Simon and said to him, "We have found the Messiah," which means Christ. He brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas," which means Peter. The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed, in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" Jesus answered him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under a fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see heaven opened and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." All right, I'm just going to pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that we have copies of your word in front of us on our phones, just so easily accessible. God, we pray for Jeremiah today as he is delivering your word. We pray that these would be your words and not his. Lord, for everyone listening, I pray that our minds would be free of distraction, of any thoughts, any anxieties or any cares that we've brought in from the last week or thinking about in the next week. I pray that we would lay those down, just be able to clear our minds and hear what you have to say to us today. Thank you that we can be here worshiping you today. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Ali. Yeah, have a seat. Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you. My name's Jeremiah. I am the lead pastor here at Urban Grace. If you are new or just visiting this morning, welcome. We are so glad to have you. Urban Grace is a church that is all about Jesus. We hope that is evident in everything that we say and do this morning. If you have any questions about Urban Grace, come and find me afterwards. I'd love to chat with you then. If you're watching online, welcome to you there. Glad that you could join us. If you have any questions about how you can get involved in Urban Grace, just shoot us an email, hello@urbangracechurch.ca, and myself or someone from our team will be in contact with you there. As always, I would recommend that you follow along with a Bible in your hand. If you didn't bring a Bible and you'd like one, just raise your hand. Someone will bring a Bible to you. We want everyone to have a copy of God's Word, so that is our gift to you this morning. We are continuing in the Gospel of John this morning. Last week, we saw in John's Gospel our first physical glimpse of Jesus as he arrived on the scene, and John the Baptist pointed to him and declared that Jesus was the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And today, we'll see the first words of Jesus recorded in John's Gospel as Jesus calls his first disciples to himself. And we'll see that what we're invited into and what flows out from us through a life that is spent with Jesus. The beginning of our text that we're going to be in here this morning, John 1, 35, it serves as an awesome introduction for where we're going to go. So we're just going to jump right into the text this morning. And so if you have your Bibles, again, let's open our Bibles. Let's have our Bibles open in front of us so we can follow along and be reading along here. If you didn't bring your Bible, you didn't want to ask for one, there it is up on the screen for you if you'd like there. So let's open our Bibles. It starts out in John chapter 1 and verse 35. It says, the next day, we'll stop there. This is the day after John first proclaimed Jesus to be the Lamb of God, which is what we looked at last week. And just like what happened the day before yesterday, Jesus, again, he walks past John, and again, John, rejecting the limelight, rejecting any notion of building up his own ministry or building up his own platform for personal gain or personal glory, rejecting any idea that John can save anyone or carry the weight or the calling of the Messiah on his shoulders, John the Baptist stands with his two disciples and he looks at Jesus and again he says, "Behold the Lamb of God." Like, there he is. There's the one that I have been sent to prepare the way for. There's the one I'm pointing you all to. Behold the Lamb of God. Now we see in verse 37 that two disciples of John heard him say this and they followed Jesus. What I just think is so cool about that verse is that John's ministry and his purpose are being fulfilled right there. John said last week, "I am not the Christ, I am not Elijah, I'm not the Messiah, I'm not the prophet, I am just a voice crying out to prepare the way. I am just a road sign that's there to point you towards your final destination." And he sees Jesus again walking past him and he says, "There he is. There's the one you want to be following. There's the Christ, there's the Lamb of God sent to take away your sin. Follow him." And like I said last week, we would do really well to take note of John's example here, that we would simply just be people who want to point to Jesus, rejecting any attention or awe that's put our way and say, "Not me, but he. Look at him. Be like him. Look to him. Follow him." Making disciples isn't a task of trying to make them into my likeness. It's a task of trying to make people into Christ's likeness. And so we point them towards Jesus, and that's what John does here. Now we're told that the two of John the Baptist's disciples who left him and went to follow Jesus, and in the next verses we see that one of those disciples was called Andrew, and the other disciple is unnamed. Does anyone want to take a guess at who it is? Next? Sorry? It's the name of this book. John, good job. It's very likely John the Apostle, not John the Baptist, but John the Gospel writer. John doesn't identify himself in his Gospel. He refers to himself very humbly as the other one often, sometimes not so humbly as the one that Jesus loved. It's subtle, right? But these two disciples, Andrew and John the Apostle, they leave John the Baptist and they follow Jesus. Verse 38 says, "Jesus turned and saw them following and said to them, 'What are you seeking?'" These are the first recorded words of Jesus in John's Gospel. Jesus looks at these two men who are following and he asks them what I think is just a really interesting question. What are you seeking? And this isn't a question that is answered by anyone without some proper thought given to it. It's not just a surface level question, but one that points to their hearts, to the very core of who they are and says, what's going on? What's going on in there? What are you seeking? What are you desiring? What are you hoping to find and be invited into by following me? And this morning, whether you are here, you're a skeptic, a seeker, you're not really sure why you're here, or even if you're here and you are a committed follower of Jesus, it's a question that we must all consider and answer. What are you seeking? What am I seeking? We're all seeking something. What's the desire in your heart that gets you out of bed in the morning? What's the purpose that you're living for? Now, I think that the answer for every single one of us is that we are looking for life. We are looking for what we will think will bring us life. And I think we just put our trust in different things that we think will bring that life to us. And so for some of us, we might seek money, or we might seek religion or sex or power or family or work and job titles, whatever it might be. This morning, we might even say that I'm seeking Jesus. Well, why are you seeking Jesus? It's a question I think that Jesus asks or presents to every person who comes to follow him. Why are we seeking Jesus? Are we following him to get what we want? Are we hoping that he's just a means to give us our best life now? Like Jesus is just some magic genie or some cosmic vending machine, and if we just put in the right amount of currency or do enough of the right things, then Jesus will just have to give us what we want? Are we seeking him in some sort of half-hearted, semi-committed way that allows us to think that it's okay to just continue to live in sin and live our lives basically however we want, but now I just don't have to feel as bad about it because Jesus just has to forgive all my sins anyway? Or do you seek him for who he is? Do you seek him because you believe that he is the Lamb of God, that he is the answer to the brokenness of your sin? Do you seek him because you see that he offers us something that nothing else in the world could ever offer, that he is the nourishment and lasting satisfaction for our spiritual hunger and thirst, that he is the healing to our spiritual sickness and brokenness, that he is the way of reconciliation to the Father that we have separated ourselves from through our sin? If that's what you are seeking, you will find what you're looking for in Jesus. That is what Jesus offers us as our Savior. And so these two disciples, they are following him. Jesus turns and asks them, what are they seeking? And they respond in verse 38. And they said to him, Rabbi, which means teacher, where are you staying? Now, on the surface, maybe it's just me. It's kind of a weird response, right? These guys just start following Jesus. He says to them, hey, what do you guys want from me? And the first thing they say is like, where do you live? It's kind of a weird introduction. Maybe it's just that they've been living out in the wilderness with John the Baptist for so long, eating locusts and just sleeping outside, and they're just hoping that Jesus just lives somewhere. Anything with four walls and a roof will do. It sort of sounds like that. But it actually has a far deeper meaning. They say, Rabbi, where are you staying? And this response actually reveals their heart. It shows us what they're really after. And they don't have this sort of false motive of prominence or power or prestige in following Jesus. They're not just coming to him for what they can get from him, but it shows that they want, what they want is simply just him. We know this because we see that word staying in the disciples' response to his question, where are you staying? And it's a word that's most often translated in the Gospel of John as the word abiding. And it's an important word and verb that is going to show up a lot through the Gospel of John. And it means more than just where someone lives, like your abode, your home. It's so much more than that. But in John's Gospel, it speaks to this deep and intimate connection with Jesus, that in the same way that a branch gets life from being connected to a vine, Jesus calls his disciples to abide in him. And so this response says, we want to be with you, Jesus. We want to see how you live. We want to abide in you. Really simply, Jesus says, what are you seeking? And their response is, we're seeking you. We just want to be with you. We just want to follow you. And when this is how we come to Jesus, longing simply just to follow him for who he is, not for what we can get from him, but just to be with him, to abide with him, Jesus invites us in. He invites us to find life in him. And what we're going to see for the rest of our time is five invitations from Jesus that flow out from a life that is abiding with him. You could say five invitations that flow out from being a disciple of Jesus. So here's the first one. When we abide with Jesus, we are given an invitation to see. Look at what Jesus says. They're saying, we want you, we want to follow you. And Jesus says to them in verse 39, come and you will see. Now there is a massive amount of theology in that statement. He's not just saying, hey, come out, check out my house. It's small, but it's home or whatever. But as we'll see Jesus do throughout the Gospel of John, he is making a massive spiritual and theological statement in a very small and simple phrase. And so it's not just come and let me show you my house. It's come and follow me. Come and abide with me and your blind eyes will be open and you will see. He's saying, I will open your eyes. I will open your spiritual eyes, which were closed and blinded, and they will be open to see everything in this life for what it truly is. You are going to see yourself for who you truly are. You're going to see your brokenness and your sin for what it truly is. You're going to see the idols that you have been seeking in order to try and find life. And you're going to see the emptiness that comes from those idols. You're going to see the way that you've been grasping in the darkness, trying to find God. You'll see that there is nothing that you can do to earn your salvation, but through me, your eyes will be open to see that I am the Messiah who will save you from all of this, that I am the Lamb promised throughout the Scriptures who will lay down my life to rescue you from the brokenness of sin that you were blinded to me. Jesus says, come and you will see. This is one of the greatest joys of a life of abiding with Jesus. That I was once blind. I didn't see. I didn't understand. I didn't get it. I was just mindlessly seeking the things of this world, trying to find satisfaction. But now I see, and it's Christ. Christ is all. He is in all. It is who we are truly looking for. And it is only by the grace of God that he allows us to open up our eyes and see him for truly who he truly is. We cannot open up our blind eyes. If you place your faith in Jesus, you know this. You know what it was like to be blind. But then the message of the gospel of a Savior who loves you so much that he would give his life for you overwhelms your heart and you begin to see. I know for me, I grew up in a Christian home. I went to a Christian school. I grew up going to church every Sunday, even when I didn't want to go. And there were some long periods of times there where I did not want to go, but my eyes were blind. Until on the most unlikely of nights, in the most unlikely of places and circumstances, someone shared the gospel with me, and my heart was drawn to Jesus, and my eyes were open, and I began to see. I saw the depths of my sin, and I saw the greatness of my Savior. I saw the truth of God's word becoming more than just words on a page, but words that would bring me life and would guide my life. And this is what Jesus does when we go to abide with him. He opens up our eyes, revealing more and more of who he is and the joy of life that comes from abiding with him. So Jesus invites us to see. Invitation number two, go and tell. Verse 40, one of the two who heard John speak and followed Jesus was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. Now, Andrew is about to do something here that I would argue is just a direct result of someone who is abiding with Jesus. Their eyes have been opened. They've been illuminated to the truth and the beauty of Christ and who he is. It just enamors them. It takes over their heart, filling them up until it begins to overflow out of them. And Andrew cannot contain what's happening inside of him and what's happening in his life. And in verse 41, it says, he found his own brother, Simon, and said to him, we found the Messiah, which means Christ. He brought him to Jesus. Now, we just talked about this a couple of weeks ago on Resurrection Sunday, but that was a couple of weeks ago, and I am certain you don't remember any of that. But being with Jesus, what it means is that we have news to share. Remember what happens to the two men on the road to Emmaus. Jesus did what? He opened their eyes. Just like John and Andrew, they see. And when Jesus opens our eyes and we see him for who he is here, John and Andrew see him as the Messiah, the Christ, the one who is foretold throughout the scriptures, the one that they've been waiting for. The men on the road to Emmaus saw him as the risen and resurrected king standing in victory over sin and death. But both times, what does that lead to when their eyes are open to see who Jesus is? It leads to proclamation. To evangelism, sharing with our friends and our families and our neighbors. We have to go and tell other people about him. We have to bring people to meet Jesus. We have to get others to come and see. We have news to share. It is abiding with Jesus that leads us to go and tells others. It's abiding in Jesus that spurs on the mission. It's why we do what we just did on a Sunday morning. We pray for those who don't know Jesus, who have no hope of hearing about him unless we send people out to those unreached people groups. It's why we want you to get involved in things like Monday night evangelism. Go and share the gospel with people because it's good news. It's why we generously give to the mission and why we commission out people to go and take this message to the other side of the world. It's why we hold mission as one of the core values that we talk about every single week at Urban Grace. It's why we risk and sacrifice. We risk our comfort and our safety and we sacrifice our money. It's because like Andrew, we've seen. Our eyes are open and we just want people to meet Jesus. Friends, we have been invited into the greatest purpose of life that exists, to proclaim the gospel to others, to go and tell the good news of who Jesus is, and to bring others to Jesus so they can meet their Savior and their eyes can be opened to the joy of life that is found in him. And so let me just ask you, who is that person in your life that God is calling you to share the gospel with? And maybe like Andrew, you have a family member who needs to hear Jesus, who needs to be brought to Jesus. Maybe you've got a friend or a coworker or a schoolmate, whoever. You have been invited to go and share the good news of Jesus. Don't wait on this. Take this invitation to bring others before him. And so Andrew brings his brother Simon to meet Jesus. And look what happens, verse 42. It says, Jesus looked at him and said, "You are Simon, the son of John. You shall be called Cephas," which means Peter. And so Jesus sees Simon and he says, "You shall be called Peter." And the name Peter, Pietros or something like that in the Greek, means the rock. And what we see here is that abiding in Jesus brings transformation. And just see this. It's not that Jesus refuses to be realistic about who Simon Peter is. Jesus didn't look at Simon and say, "Man, that's the toughest guy I've ever seen. Check out that tattoo. Check out those wrestling moves, that mediocre acting skill. You're not Simon, you're the rock. That's you, man." No. Jesus sees Peter exactly as he was that day that he met him. Jesus says, "You are Simon, son of John." He's the fisherman, he's the blue collar, rough around the edges, pull out a sword and start swinging it around violently, wildly kind of guy, probably was pretty good at wrestling, but Jesus saw Simon for who he was. But Jesus also sees him for who he's meant to be, who he is going to be when Christ gets a hold of his heart and the Spirit begins to transform him from the inside out. And when he leans into the calling that God has on his life, he is going to be renamed and transformed to the rock. And if you know Peter's story, he has a long way to go. There would be a lot of foolishness and stubbornness and sin and denial. Jesus calls him, or at least his thoughts, Satan at one point. But will God get him there? Of course he will. Because Jesus sees through the carnal, sin-controlled man, and he sees the spiritual man that God created him to be, and he says, "This is who I'm going to transform you into." The same is true for you and I today. The same one who opens our eyes is the same one who will sanctify you, and he who began a good work in you will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ. He will do it. He is conforming you and transforming you into the image and likeness of his son, Jesus Christ. And sometimes we fight against him and we're stubborn, but in our faithlessness, he is faithful. He will transform us into who he has called us to be. And listen, when we come to Jesus, we abide with him in the mess of who we are today or the hurt and shame of our past. That is not what defines you. Jesus is the one who defines you. And so the hurt that you have experienced or the loss that you've experienced or the mistakes that you've made, your parenting failures, your relationship problems, the things that you did you think you can never forgive yourself of, or the things that were done against you and you think you can never forgive that person, Jesus is saying those things don't define you anymore. I'm going to transform you. I'm going to give you a new name. I'm going to give you a new identity. I'm going to give you a new future, a new heart. I'm going to give you a new hope. This is what God does, and this is what he promises to do. The word of God tells us and declares to us that if you are his, then this is how he sees you. This is what the Bible says to you if you are in Jesus. If you trust Jesus, then you are a child of God. You are a friend of Jesus. You are righteous and redeemed. You are a new creation. You are a temple of the Holy Spirit. You are an heir of God. You are chosen, holy, and blameless. You are God's workmanship. You are a citizen of heaven, and you are loved by God. This is the invitation to us when we abide in Christ. We are transformed into the person that he calls us to be in him. And the next invitation that we have, number four, it's in verse 43. It says, the next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and said to him, follow me. Follow me. It's an invitation into relationship. And notice that Jesus doesn't say to Philip, gain a bunch of knowledge and facts about me. But his invitation is follow me. To follow Jesus is what it means to be a disciple. A disciple is simply one who follows Jesus. And Jesus calls us to follow him because it's in that relationship that we discover who he truly is. It is in following Jesus that we discover what he loves, and then we start to love what he loves and discover what he thinks. And then we start to think like he thinks and act like he acts and speaks like he speaks. You know, following Jesus is how our passions and desires of the flesh are put to death, because we find our true joy and our ultimate satisfaction is found in following him. But we also have to see that following Jesus means a rejection of our heart's allegiance to anything or anyone else. And just like it was in their day, today we have no shortage of people and ideas and movements that call us to follow them. I mean, one of the most popular cultural refrains for us today is follow your heart. But the call to follow Jesus is an exclusive calling. It is a call to give your allegiance to him, and anything else that would call for our attention or our money or our vote or our voice is seen and given only under the lordship of Jesus. Following him ought to shape and inform how we live in every single part of our lives. And that is such a huge part of why we want you to be involved in community. Just like Dave said, we want to see you in a city group because our hearts are so distracted by all the things going on in this world, calling for our attention and to follow them. We are so prone to follow other people and other things that lead us away from following Jesus. And so we need one another to call each other out of those allegiances and attitudes of sin that we might be following in this world, and call us back to Jesus, back to following the person who truly offers us life. And so let me just ask you, how is following Jesus affecting your life? How is your family or your home different because you're following Jesus? How is your workplace different? How is your neighborhood different because you're following Jesus? Are you following him in his love for others, the marginalized, the outsider? Are you following him by laying down? Follow Jesus should change everything inside of us. Verse 44. Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" Philip said to him, "Come and see." Just, I want us to notice just for a minute here what Philip just did. Jesus calls him to follow him, and Philip's already going out and sharing the good news. "Nathanael, we found him. We found the Messiah. Let's bring you to him." Look what Philip said to Nathanael. Nathanael kind of makes an off-color joke about the city of Nazareth. Philip says to him, "Come and see." He's already talking like Jesus. His heart is being transformed in an abiding relationship with Jesus. Verse 47, Jesus saw Nathanael coming toward him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed in whom there is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" And Jesus answered him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." And Jesus answered him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than this." And he said to him, "Truly, truly, I say to you, you will see the heavens open and the angels of God ascending and descending on the Son of Man." Last point for us this morning. We have an invitation to reconciliation. Nathanael is brought to Jesus by Philip. Jesus calls Nathanael by name and speaks to his character, an Israelite in whom there is no deceit. And Nathanael is just perplexed at how Jesus would know this. And Jesus kind of says, "I'm God. I know everything." He says, "I saw you under the fig tree even when Philip walked up on you." This isn't Jesus saying like, "Yeah, when we walked into town, I saw you sitting under that fig tree." This is him saying, "Nathanael, I see everything. I'm God. I know it all." And immediately, Nathanael sees. His eyes are opened. He declares who Jesus is, Son of God, King of Israel. And Jesus says, "Nathanael, things are going to start happening that are going to make me seeing you under a fig tree look like nothing. You're going to see heaven open, and you'll see the angels of God ascending and descending on me." And what Jesus is saying here at the end is a reference back to Genesis chapter 28, to a story about a man named Jacob who has this dream. And in his dream, he sees this staircase or this ladder that is going up to the heavens, and the angels are ascending and descending on it. And it's a way for heaven to touch earth, for God and man to dwell together, this staircase, this ladder. And since Genesis 3, our problem has been that God and man cannot dwell with one another. God in his glory and perfection has been separated from men and women because of our sin. And the question has always been, how can this separation be overcome? At one point, just a few chapters back in Genesis, we see people trying to build a tower up to heaven, and God thwarts their plan because we could never do anything on our own that would allow us to get to God on our own efforts. But we needed something or someone to come and overcome the chasm between God and man and to reconcile us to him. And Jesus is saying that stairway, that ladder between heaven and earth that mankind has been wanting for and hoping for, it is me. And you will see this come to pass through me. You will be brought into reconciliation to God through me. Now, I am the ladder, I am the stairway, I am the connection between heaven and earth that allows you to be reconciled to God, something that you could never do on your own efforts. And as we'll see in John, this invitation to reconciliation with God comes through the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. That when Jesus took the punishment for all our sin upon himself and the wrath of God was poured out on him in our place, Jesus gave us access to God. Heaven touched earth. The curtain that separated us from God was torn. The chasm between God and man was erased, and we can now freely come to God through Jesus Christ. This is the greater thing that Nathanael and the other disciples will see. This is the invitation to us all this morning. That in all of our seeking And in all of our attempts to find life, we can find what we're truly looking for and what will truly satisfy us. And it is through a reconciled relationship with God through Jesus Christ. By abiding with him, our eyes are open, our lives are given the greatest purpose, and we are transformed and called into a relationship with him that brings us life, abundant life. And this invitation in Jesus, to life in Jesus, is offered to all of us. Jesus says to us all, come and see. Let's go to him now. Please pray with me. Jesus, we thank you that you have invited us in to abide with you. That, Lord, you do not keep us at a distance, but you call us to have life so deeply and so intimately with you that we would be able to connect ourselves and find our own lives only from you. To find the life that you offer, that abundant life is only given to us through abiding with you, Jesus. And so I pray, God, that for every single one of us here, whether we are a Christian, we feel close to you, whether we are not a believer, we might feel far from you, for every one of us here, God, that same question that you asked your first disciples would speak right into the depths of our hearts. That we would examine what we are seeking, but God, we would see that if it is anything except you and abiding in you, then God, we are selling ourselves so short because nothing can offer the abundant life to us that you offer except you. God, there is no life apart from you. All of our idols, all of the things that we chase after, God, they will never lead us towards that abundant life that only you can give. And so I pray, Lord Jesus, like we see with John and Andrew, we too would say, we just want you. We just want to come to you. We just want what you can give us. God, I pray that through abiding with you, we would see these things that should just naturally flow out of our life come to pass in our lives. That, Lord, our eyes would be open more and more each day to see you for who you really are. That, Lord, we would have a burning within us that makes us have to go and proclaim the good news of Jesus. That we would be transformed by you. That we would not stay stuck in the mess of our lives that we are currently in, but Lord, we would be transformed by you and who you tell us that we are. God, I pray that we would follow you more closely today, and God, I pray that we would take this invitation to reconciliation that you offer us, that through the cross of Christ, man and God can be reconciled to one another, the chasm that was caused by our sin can be closed. God, we can dwell with one another. We thank you for the gifts of salvation that you alone can give us. Change us, Lord. Make us more like your Son, Jesus. It's in your name we pray. Amen.